Okay, I think good morning. I'm going to commence the session. And I am looking at the attendees. I see a few faces, or rather not faces, but names I recognize. So a very, very warm welcome to a second of a series of masterclasses presented by the Cape Town, by the Western Cape Provincial Government. Wesgro through the Department of Economic Development and Tourism and the unit that manages destination marketing for the province. I will introduce our panelists to you in a second, and I really just want to open up my own presentation just to make sure that you all know what we're going to go to be doing today. And I really want to just introduce myself. I am Kornakoch. I head up the Cape Town and, sorry, that's not the right screen. Not the best one here. Let me just make sure that I've got the right one for you. Here we go. Sorry, I seem to be having some connectivity issues. So I'm just going to go ahead and just talk to my slides. Let me start again and do it properly. So I'm Kornakoch. I head up the Cape Town and Western Cape Convention Bureau, and we are part of the tourism marketing division for the Western Cape of the province. And my role is really just, we are on the eventing side, but on the conferencing space. So we are the same as you, want to make sure people have a great experience, but on a conferencing side, conferencing exhibitions and incentive space. So that's the space I play into. And today, it is my pleasure to welcome esteemed colleagues within our industry. We've been hit by the pandemic, nothing new to us now. And as we are growing out of 21 and looking forward to 2020, or rather out of 20 and looking forward to 21, we know that we have this new world that we're living in, and that's the world of virtual events. And how we're adapting and how did we adapt during 2020. And with me today are people sharing their knowledge and ideas and what happened from an adaptation perspective into that. So it's my pleasure to introduce our panelists to you. But before I do that, we have another great person in our presence, and that's Dr. Lyndon Boer. It is a pleasure for me to welcome you, Dr. Boer, to the panel today. Dr. Boer is the Chief Director for Sport and Recreation at the Western Cape Department of Cultural Affairs and Sport. What a long name. So the nice acronym for that is DCAS. Dr. Boer has been with the department since 2011, and he's mainly responsible to promote sport and recreation for the Western Cape. It's really great to have you with us, Dr. Boer. He's also assisted the industry in drafting the National Sport and Recreation Plan for 21. He's got a very nice long CV, which is really great. And it's he's a bundle of energy, and it's always nice to have you with us, Dr. Boer. Dr. Boer is going to talk to us today about the fact that we are looking into the whole case of sport and the economy of sport and tourism. And I'm not even going to say anything more, but hand over to you, Dr. Boer, and thank you for joining us.
Corne, thank you very much, and good morning, everybody. It's lovely to be here, and also great to be part of these webinars with Wesgro and the Western Cape Government. We're going to have Mushfika put on the slides. I've just prepared a short presentation that we'd be able to look at this morning. So let's start immediately. As we've got, I'm from the Department of Cultural Affairs and Sport, and I'm responsible for sport and recreation, and of course, sport tourism. And my colleague Guy Redman, who's responsible for culture, will also be joining us at some stage today. So in the last 10 years, we have commissioned a study called The Case for Sport, and we have already published two books on this matter. And one of the important ones is that we have found that sport in the Western Cape contributes in excess of 8.8 billion rand to the Western Cape economy. Now, that is a very significant number because it also represents close to 2% of the provincial GDP. And within that, we have realized that areas such as the Western Cape, Gauteng and KwaZulu-Natal, in fact, have a very large footprint when it comes to eventing. And that is a very important one. And what we have looked at also from a government perspective as the department and as the Western Cape is that there are in excess of 60,000 jobs that is related to the sport and the recreation sector across the Western Cape. And whether one thinks about somebody working in the event industry, somebody working at a gym at Virgin Active, or somebody that's just a groundsman, all of those people are actually working in the sport and recreation sector. So COVID has severely affected us. The impact has been huge. And of course, these figures, as we will record them in a year's time, will probably be much lower. Thank you, Mashrika. So when we come to our actual discussion, we also find that within sport and recreation in the province, we're very, very closely linked to the hospitality industry. If one thinks about the cycle tour, you think about the hotels, you think about guest houses, you think about the restaurants, you think about the jazz festival that takes place, Outswim Sport Festival, Nisna Oyster, any of those ones that you wish to mention, then we know that we have knock-on effects on all the economies that we have within the towns and within the cities of the Western Cape. We also have been part of a number of mega events, and many of you will know that we of course had the FIFA World Cup 2010, and then of course we have also been awarded the Netball World Cup 2023, and then we also have been awarded the Rugby Sevens for 2022, and that is the World Cup for rugby that will take place in Cape Town as well. So many of these events are part of our mega and large sport events, and it's part of the provincial event strategy, and each one of them have an important economic spin-off for the province as well. We also believe that as we have more cultural events and community-based sport events, those contribute particularly in the lower socioeconomic conditions that exist. If we can spread our events to all over the Western Cape, there would be more people that would be able to invest and also be able to market their own particular wares that they make. And we also know that whether or not it's transport industry that is affected because people have to travel, whether it's people that have to make tracksuits in the textile industry, all of those are part and parcel of what we call the economic spin-offs of sport and recreation and, of course, culture as well. Thanks, Mashrika. So from our side, as a sports sector, we support close to 150 events across the Western Cape in any normal financial year. This year has been different. We probably only have about 40 events that will be happening up until the end of March. But in our normal year, over the last 8 to 9 years, we have tracked about 150 events. And they can start off with from the Two Oceans Marathon, which is a big one, to the Cape Town Marathon, to smaller events, wherever they may take place, in whatever small town or city. But we are supporting those particular events because they're very important. Then we also have the cultural events. And one of our big ones, of course, is the car and Outswim that didn't take place this year, the jazz festival that didn't take place. But we also have various smaller cultural events that take place that the department also supports. The COVID-19 pandemic has, of course, hit the industry very, very hard. And we've seen this, and the department, together with the national department, has tried to have some what we call the relief funding. And we've seen hundreds of people apply for the relief funding that has also taken place. So one can see that something like that pandemic has hit the industry. And in fact, we are still suffering because of that. And I'm hoping that this webinar is part of the process, Corné, to resuscitate the industry so that we can have the necessary debates, get some solutions from industry, some suggestions and proposal, so that we are able as government to hold hands with the industry so that we can go forward. Corné, thank you very much. And I look forward to the contributions today. Thank you very much.
Otabo, thanks so much. You've said some pertinent words there in terms of hard hit. And I think just in this year, the event professionals will forever remember this year. There's unfortunately a lot of there's a lot of adaptation, which is amazing. There's also a lot of loss in the industry in terms of the supply chain, in terms of companies that couldn't make it or can't adapt to this environment. And I think that's the relevance of today's presentation, is to talk about what are the new things that we're looking ahead. There's safety concerns, there's the way that we do events, and there's also I mean, the changes are profound for our industry, sport, event, a conference, anything, not even to talk about the sport, because in sport you cannot do a virtual sport, but maybe you can, and Barry is here to help us on that. So thank you so much. And then without further ado, I now am able to navigate my mouse again. My mouse did a bit of a beautiful stuck on me. And I just quickly want to run with you for a few things. And again, welcome to everybody else who's there now joined us as part of this panel. And we will, I just want to quickly run through a few, some of the house rules. We are recording this webinar, so it will be available afterwards if you feel that you want to revisit or that you want to co-share it. We will mute everybody just for sake of ease of reference and for sake of our panels. We will take questions in the Q&A. So if you could do, anybody of our participants are welcome to put a question in there, and our panelists will then answer it in the window, or we will then address it during the webinar. There's a few hashtags for you if you wanted to look into that. And now it is my pleasure to just introduce the speakers to you. I've already introduced Dr. Boer. We will hear from Barry van Black, who's the general manager for the Sanlam Cape Town Marathon. Barry joined the sector in a very interesting time. Barry, well done to you. He joined in March 2020. What a time to join join an event company. From your experience, a welcome to us. Andrew Finn is a true, I don't know if there's such a word as a Naisna Knight or a Naisna Yit, Andrew, but Naisna and Andrew is together. They form part of the landscape. I'm sure Andrew's got a very, very good an asset register number in Naisna. So he very welcome, Andrew, and the story about the Oyster Festival is phenomenal, and how we did this in a virtual world this year. So welcome to the event. And then Shai Evian is the CEO for Howler. And Shai is going to deal with us about the virtual landscape and what it meant this year and the adaptation to it. So a beautiful panelist for us to talk about. And I will introduce all of them now. And before we do that, I would like to individually then go to Barry and Andrew and Shai. So Barry, I'm going to start with you just to show us a nice intro of just what we're going to be talking about. Thank you.
Mishfika, if you're ready.
I'm very happy to win this race. I didn't expect to win it because of I was running against the fast horse, but I gave it a shot and then I ran my PB today. So I'm very happy about the time that I've run today.
At the seventh Sanlam Cape Town Marathon, the first Sanlam Cape Town virtual marathon. We are here because we believe this race is a really important one, and especially in 2020. You know, it's the only gold label marathon on the continent. Continent's very important to us from a business perspective. We want to, you know, invest in the people of the continent, and we're trying to make an impact in people's lives.
We'll be right back.
organisers of the Cape Town Marathon. I mean, they moved mountains to actually put on this race, an amazing virtual race, all immersive. Even though it wasn't the physical thing here in Cape Town, it was still a big achievement and we've still impacted many lives through it.
Thank you, Ms. Fika, and thank you, Corneille, and welcome to all the guests. It's a pleasure to be here and to share our experiences with you today. Obviously, from what you can see on the video, it was a very different event compared to previous years. And I'll touch later on the key differences and what we did differently. But I think for us, in terms of COVID and the uncertainty this year, we proud ourselves that we made a few very key decisions early on, which allowed us to be geared for all possibilities and to offer runners a goal and a race to train for. In terms of key decision gates, we first announced the virtual race parallel to the original or the actual race, which then gave runners certainty during a very certain uncertain times, especially in those first few weeks or months of COVID. We then unfortunately had to announce the cancellation of the actual event a few weeks after that, but the decision was taken collectively with the City of Cape Town, Western Province Athletics, as well as ASA. And what we're also very proud of is that we offered all the runners who's already entered the actual race a full refund. And that is part of the DNA of our organization, in that we put athletes first in everything we do, and we just felt that was the right thing to do. Key decisions we made later on was we also announced a virtual race, which is not something we normally do in a normal year. But overall, we're very proud of what we achieved under very difficult or challenging circumstances. And we caught the attention of World Athletics and other international sports events companies with what we offer, not only the elite runners, but also social runners in the app, which I will tell you a little bit later about.
Excellent. Thank you, Barry. That's amazing. And it's a nice introduction and makes me also realize why we do events, to see these things, emotive things all the time. So thanks for sharing that with us. I'm going to allow Andrew Finn. He's the coordinator for the Naismith Oyster Festival. As I said, he's lived in Naismith since 1982. And that's why I call him a true Naismithite. I think I've just created a new word. But he's been involved with the Oyster Festival for many, many years. And Andrew, some opening comments on your side. Welcome again. You'll have to unmute yourself, Andrew.
So if we can just play the clip now, Mashika, and then I'll speak to what I was going to say after that. We seem to have a technical here. Sorry, that didn't work.
Let's play the video towards the end, Andrew, if that's okay. I think it would be great to go with still. So when they sorted out the...
Yeah, if they've got a problem, I'll do it, if you like, just now. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, just to give you a bit of background, everyone. Obviously, the Naismith Oyster Festival has been running for many, many years. And back in, I think, early 80s was the first year. And it's never had a cancellation, and We've had one incident where the Forest Marathon, and I think Barry will assess, go along with that, where the Forest Marathon was washed out in a flood. But anyway, going into this year, we had all things lined up, and we thought everything was going well until, well, Andrew was actually overseas when it all started happening. But we had our lockdown on the 27th of March. And at that stage, we actually thought we could still go ahead with the event. But then on reconsidering, around about the middle of April, about the 9th of April or so, we said, well, it's not really practical. We're not going to be able to run the event as we anticipated this year. And we made the call, and that's between us and our partners, Neisner, Visit Neisner, and the local stakeholders, that we would actually cancel the event. And we even went to the extent of publicizing that and doing press releases. But then we've thought about it. I mean, an event, be it a festival, be it a cape, be it a marathon, they've got space on the calendar. And we realized that we actually can't lose that space. So we then looked at going virtual. So it took us a couple of days to get our heads around that. And by the end of April, we'd made the call that we were going to go ahead. And we then got to work on planning that. We initially just thought, well, what we'll do is we'll do a two-day session where we'll broadcast the cycle and the marathon. And that will kind of be it. But then we had a rethink on it. And we thought, well, no, let's rather let people experience, not from Neisner, what they would have experienced in Neisner during the whole period. So we then approached our local suppliers, if you'd like to call them that, in the entertainment, food and beverage industry, and said, well, guys, look, let's make this thing fun, and let's put something on that people can watch and enjoy during that week. So we then basically got all our players on board, or most of the players on board, and asked them to produce either a pre-recorded clip for a time period during this week, or we would do their production live. I think our next speaker is going to quite enjoy some of the challenges that we went through. So I kind of have an IT background, so it was helped a little, but we then had to try and get everybody to do something and put something together. And the challenge was quite a technical challenge, because you can't just live stream a thing straight onto Facebook from a home connection with a telecom one up and 10 down. You just haven't got the bandwidth. It doesn't work. So we were fortunate in that we got a service provider as a partner, to the extent that they allowed us to put a box in their office connected to their main data feed. And we then did our live feed from our live or our virtual feed from local, which would be through our local telecom system or for Vodacom or whatever it was, to this box. And then from there, we broadcast. So that's how we basically put this thing on. But each event had to put their thing together on their own. We had the cycle race, Neisner Cycle Tour, on the first weekend. And they put on an amazing show. They went on Zwift. And they did a Zwift show on the Saturday and the Sunday. And then on Sunday afternoon, they did a professional ride with international cyclists. They had full commentary. It was really quite an exciting event. We even had a sailing regatta that first weekend. And then during the week, we then put together the other activities. So why do people come to our town? They come to visit the town. They come to experience the arts and the culture and the entertainment. So we had how to get hold of an oyster. We had a show on that. We had how to cook certain meals, and we had live music evenings. They were fun. We basically did, instead of doing two events, we ended up doing 42 events. We had a calendar of 42 events. There are a number of things we can improve on going forward.
Perhaps before you do that, what I want to do is I want to allow each of you to still have continuation, because we want to talk about the hows and all the nuggets that you want to share with us. So I'm going to jump to Shay and then back to you. So if you could hold that, because that's quite important, the fact that you originally planned one thing and it ended up being 42. And those are actually 42 little different events in a bigger event, which is a considerable amount of extra work that's not normally planned for. So thanks for opening that for us, Andrew. If you could just hold some of that thoughts, and I am going to come back to you as well. Shai, I wanted to give you some opening comments. You also have a video. Shai is he's a serial entrepreneur, is the way he describes himself. And he's actually doing some disruption in the global events industry. He's got a history of success in his vision to transform event technology. And he's got about 18 years experience on that. He searches for innovation, where he can find it. And he's also the co-founder of Liquid Chefs, which is a mobile bar company that's also revolutionized the events. And right now, he is a big player in terms of the driving force about event expansion and the delivery of events on an online or a virtual or a technical platform. Shay, so welcome here as well. And if you've got some opening comments, then we can gonna come back to each one of you and discuss some of the issues we'd like to talk to you about today as well.
Great, thank you. Thanks, Cornay, for that introduction, and great to be on this panel with everyone else. Just a quick intro for people who are unfamiliar with Howler. Pre-COVID, you know, we're a full end-to-end event technology platform, you know, so we work with some of the biggest organizers in the country, helping them host successful events, everything from ticketing, payments, cashless events, vendor management. You know, we really see ourselves as kind of the heartbeat of the experience economy. And yeah, I think as COVID came, firstly, we had an absolute nightmare with the fact that we had hundreds of events that needed to be canceled overnight. Dealing with that was an interesting process. And very quickly, you know, we had to adapt and pivot ourselves into a growing need and demand, especially in this online space. What we found is, you know, we had all of these clients who wanted to do things, and they're like, what do we do? How do we even do this? It's been, you know, I think the first part of lockdown in the first few months was very focused in kind of the live music entertainment space, you know, really seeing how we could use our platform to give an environment for artists, musicians, organizers to bring things online, really from an entertainment and keeping people's spirits up during lockdown. That was very much the focus. And obviously the industry has really, you know, shifted over the last kind of 6 to 8 months, where we've seen there's been a lot less in the kind of live music space, and it's been moving more into kind of the corporate exhibition and how we can support that. So I just want to quickly show you a video of the first event that we enabled, which was the Dream Stream. It happened end of April. We put this together literally in the space of a week and a half. I believe it was probably one of the biggest online events in South Africa. We had a huge audience globally. We raised close on R1 million for a fund that we set up called SAFE, which was really about to support the industry at the ground level. I think we'll quickly show this, and then I want to quickly show you a little bit of the platform stuff that we've done, and then we can move on.
Welcome to the Dream Stream, the online digital festival experience that emerged from a locked-in world and created a world with no boundaries, that gave us a space for connection, a playground for meeting new people, a place where your rules ruled. You immersed yourself in your favorite sounds and experienced new musical talents in your home, in your lounge, in your hearts, all for a good cause. The Dream Stream, a Howler initiative in support of SAFE, the South African Fund for Entertainment. It welcomed 50,000 viewers from 130 countries, virtually connecting them through music and good vibes. Born in South Africa, the Dream Stream is the world's largest Zoom music festival on one platform to date. 35 DJs, and 9,000 Zoom users having the time of their lives and raising $500,000 for SAFE. Who would have thought you'd have so much fun at home? What have we learned? That whether you're alone or with your people, the only thing holding you back is your imagination. So, be prepared for the next virtual experience and help the Dream Stream to smash a goal of $1 million to support the entertainment industry. Make a donation now and enter a world with no boundaries.
Sure, I get goosebumps just watching that. So that was end of April, and from there we saw that we actually had something that we could give to our clients, and you know, thereafter, yeah, we saw many events come online. A lot of it was really in aid of fundraising and keeping people entertained during that process. And yeah, I think, as I said, like, we've gone through a roller coaster, you know, in terms of trying to build solutions for different needs. This, by nature, events have so many, are different. Every event's different and people have different requirements. But we really got quick to work at building, you know, a platform that gives a lot of versatility to customers. I just want to quickly share my screen, if I can quickly do this. And kind of to give a bit of an insight into,
Shay, I think before we navigate that, and then because I think what I want to do is of go back. We're on the just over halfway on the session, yeah. I'm going to allow Barry, Andrew, and Shay to go a bit deeper, because I think now, you know, there are things like the evolution of events, audience engagement, the whole issue about sponsors wants ROI, how on earth are we doing that, and how are we adapting to that? You know, is it suitable in the long run to do sustainable events? What did we learn? So each of you have like a take on and I would like to invite you to sort of continue on what you've opened with, so that we can get some engagement on it, because this is almost like a topic you can, if I just say adding value, we can talk an entire day about adding value to the event. So it would be really great to sort of give you each another 5 minutes and then go through it, and let's talk a bit about the evolvement on that and the evolving business models and what it means for your company. Barry, if I can start and go back to you. Thanks, Shay.
So, you know, some of the questions come up is how is our event different to previous years? And you can't even compare it. It was completely different. We went in a normal year, we would have had 5 events, which is a marathon, a 10 and a 5 kilometer road races, and then 2 trail runs as well. And all of them would be hosted in the greater Cape Town City Bowl area, foreshore area. But this year we had 4 events across South Africa, Africa and the world, which was made up of 3 elite invitational races in Cape Town, Pretoria and Potchefstroom, and then one virtual global race. The elite invitational, which you could see on the video, was a measured course, as I said, Pretoria, Potch and Cape Town, with timing mats. Whereas the virtual race for the social runner, we built a purpose-built app that tracked and measured the runners via the app, so people had to run with their cell phones. Part of the app was the app didn't only measure and track the runners, but it also offered runners and fully immersive surround sound Cape Town audio experience. The runners got to experience the sounds of Cape Town and also hear about key landmarks through the app. So runners were virtually tracked on the actual Cape Town Marathon route, and as if they on 14.1 kilometers on the actual marathon, you would have run past City Hall and Nelson Mandela standing on their balcony. Now the app told you about, you're now here at this point on the virtually on the on the race, whether you were running in Bloemfontein or in Bangkok, wherever, you heard about everybody at 14.1 kilometer in their run got the same audio experience and heard about the same landmarks. So they were, and then on the marathon distance run, there was 32 audio clips built into the app. What I will do is I will post on the chat now, I will post two YouTube links for you to listen to. It's a 1 minute sound clip that you could get a feel for after the webinar, that you can get a feel for what runners would have experienced, and we're very proud of it. You know, it was really exciting. It was a world first, and very, very unique. So also another question that came up was our event totally virtual, or were there other components as well? For the social runner, it was only a completely virtual race. For the elite runners in the three destinations across Africa, it was an actual race. We had Professor Ross Tucker build in a handicap calculator. So it was obviously running in Pretoria and Potch, running at altitude compared to people running in Cape Town. So there was just to level the playing fields, he took into consideration the number of turns, the steepness of the turn, because runners would lose time if it's a sharp end. How much climbing they got on the course compared to so only after the last runner started. All the runners started 6:15 on the same time. Only after everybody's finished, we applied the calculator and the overall winner were announced. But we also, one of our objectives was to give runners, the social runners, an experience as close to the real thing as possible. So, you know, runners are used to getting a race t-shirt, a goodie bag, a finisher's medal, a race bib, and we got all of that. So we sent that to runners in advance, and we also had something that was very unique. We had 18 refreshment stations across the country in partnership with Woolworths and Peninsula Beverages. So, and we announced these locations beforehand, so runners could plan their run, measure out the run, and plan that they run past one or two of these Woolies water tables, which is obviously runners need to eat and to drink. So it just helped. And we had branding of sponsors there. So it's also added value for our partners and sponsors.
I'm going to give you 1 more minute.
Okay. Just you asked before about the return on investment for sponsors, and we, despite it being virtual, we measured more or less the same return on investment from a advertising value equivalent compared to a normal race. And this was achieved through, we had the elite race, and part of the virtual race was live broadcast on SABC, and we had more or less the same social reach compared to previous years as well. But on top of a normal event, we also offered our sponsors and partners new opportunities. For instance, an early adapter status. So the first World Marathon rated event to announce a virtual race, an app-based virtual race. We offered our partners and sponsors opportunity for their offices outside of South Africa and their staff and members outside of South Africa to also take part in the virtual race. And because in the past, I mean, not everybody can travel to Cape Town. And we also offered Woolies, for instance, the opportunity to do activations across the country compared to a normal year where there's only one activation in Cape Town itself. And at the same time, we also attracted new sponsors. Take a Lot was a new sponsor of ours this year because they helped us with the distribution of all the goodie bags, the race medals, the race t-shirts. So it was Horses for Courses. This year was new challenges, new opportunities, and we had to get the right partners and sponsors this year for the new needs and the new demands.
Excellent. I think it's the word about innovation that it resonates, and that it is sort of, if you call it the new normal, I suppose that is what we want to say, new normal, and the way that you're adapting sponsors, audience engagement, and the experience. Barry, thanks for that. I am Andrew. Let me jump straight to you. You were on a roll just now. We wanted to sort of just to have an opening, you were quite talking about the fact that you had about 48 events. I'm going to give you another three minutes to just, you know, go into depth, Andrew, on your side in terms of that experience and how you, how that was managed. Thank you.
Okay, but hi, thanks. But can I just quickly show that video so you can get an idea of what we did?
And that's fine, Andrew.
I'm going to just show it quickly. Eh?
And then we will.
Then we'll talk after it. It's a very quick. It's only 58 seconds. It's starting now. Can you see it?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so you might have an idea of what I was trying to portray there. So we actually almost turned into a film production organization, which Shai, I'm sure, will appreciate. So we ran, with the 42 events, we actually ran three sessions a day for 8 days, where we had different scheduled events according to our schedule. And we played them, we did pre-promotion, in other words, generic promotion of our town, which you saw those beautiful shots of Teeson Island and the heads. And then we then highlighted specific parts of the activities in the area, like your forests, your canoeing, your running, your cycling. So every event was, each section we did was different. So obviously we had to get a lot of footage and put a whole lot of stuff together to get that to happen. So that in itself was actually quite an interesting exercise, and it actually worked fairly well. I was going to say there's some things we can learn from it. We had too much space in between our activities, so people had to wait, which was a bit of a problem. So you'd have somebody starting at 6, the next person at 7, but the 6 o'clock guy finished at 6:30 instead of 7, and you had a half an hour to fill. So it wasn't very clever. But going back to promotion of the event, first of all, we had a bit of an issue initially with getting people, that's now the people that we wanted to participate, to actually understand that they would actually be getting exposure and have value in doing it. And it took some persuading to get material and get people to become involved in doing the show, if you'd like to call it that. And so for the participant, we then had to basically, we as the festival did the social media, we did the conventional marketing, and we also contacted previous people who'd been to the town. So our whole marketing package was focused on, first of all, we're going to have this thing. Secondly, you actually have to watch it during the week. So when you're at home, instead of participating in going to a pub evening or music evening, watch it live with us rather. So it was a totally different concept. So pre, we had to tell them it's happening. And then on the day, it was get a hold of those people and tell them to watch now. And it was a totally different concept. And it was quite a lot to get your head around, because social media is usually what has happened or what's going to happen in the future, not now. That took quite a lot. Then with respect to commercializing it, none of our participants really made much and didn't really work commercially for them. But they all got good coverage through the exposure of the event. The advantage, and I think speaking to what Barry was saying, you saw that we had that wrapped movie, if you'd like to call it that, that everybody saw. There's enormous potential for sponsors there because that's getting broadcast worldwide. And as long as you get enough of a footprint, there's extreme value in sponsors in that. And I think this year was perhaps a little early for people to understand that value. And for we put people on there who gave us VRK, and they got a hell of a lot more value than their VRK. And I think going forwards, I think all events need to look at that quite carefully.
Yeah,
and I'm sure Shai agrees with me on that.
Yes. Andrew, thanks. You've mentioned a real interesting nugget is the fact that you got to also have to think about how to engage people on an immediate basis, and the whole thing about keeping the engagement and inviting the engagement to take place and what it looks like. And I think next year, if we have the same discussion, you're going to give us a beautiful set of learnings from this year into next, because now we've opened that recipe book and we've talked to that. Shai, I'm going to jump to you now. Andrew, thank you so much. I wish we had more time now. I'm so interested in these topics. Shai, another 5 minutes for you, and then we can talk a bit about some questions people have. I wanted us to also talk about the added skills, because you've just mentioned about a TV production, and that's absolutely true, that eventing no longer is just setting the time for coffee breaks and for refreshments breaks, but we are now having to learn new skills to actually present these things as we go along. Shai, thanks, over to you. I'll give you a heads up in 5 minutes. I'm so sorry, everybody, Barry and Andrew, that I have to chip in. Thanks.
So, yeah, thank you again. I think, you know, what both Barry and Andrew mentioned is, you know, finding the right platform to do these events was probably the biggest challenge, I think, during COVID. One, because this was a whole new industry that just exploded overnight. In South Africa, there weren't really many, there were a lot of broadcast partners, but not really platforms that could actually facilitate all the different needs and requirements. There have been a lot of global platforms, but those come at a cost. You know, there's no local support. And I think, you know, this is where we kind of shifted our development into what can we put together to provide clients with a full multifaceted platform. And I just want to give you a bit of a insight into kind of what we did. So this was the Lurie Awards. I'm sure you all know the Lurie Awards are the biggest media awards online. What we really did is we created a media platform that allowed customers to really customize their event, knowing that each event is different. So as you can see here, you have your program, which is, you know, talk about the speakers that were happening. We had a live feed that we could bring in over here. We had a chat functionality that we added. We had this was the kind of the keynote speakers, conversations. We had info about all the finalists, all the previous day's content. So there was content on demand and we had live content that you could watch. We had an area for sponsors. So for each sponsor, they then had their own page. So let's say Sunlam, for example, we would then give them a replica of the site and they could do their own thing. So for example, here, they had all their campaigns that you could watch, their art gallery. Like, it's a real content hub. And I think, you know, for another example here, the Rage Expo, this was bringing that gaming expo online. And again, totally different needs, different audiences. But just to show you how we kind of adapted the platform, you know, for different clients. Here they had their own exhibitors. Based on this, exhibitors had their own platform, the different streamer zones. You could watch their streams. And then just the Cannabis Expo, which was actually one of the events that take place in Cape Town. We brought this online as well. And this was quite an interesting project because they had free access so people could watch free content. And then you could upgrade to the delegates ticket. And then that gave you a whole lot more access to talk to the exhibitors, the delegates. Here you can kind of rewatch all the content that was done on demand. This was a list of all the exhibitors. And then each exhibitor literally had their own page. So, I mean, I think there were close on 70 exhibitors in this environment. So, you know, I think the platform really is important. I want to stress, you know, this is locally built, you know, and the fact that when we work with clients in South Africa with us here, we're providing more jobs. It's not supporting these international platforms. And the talking about the analytics and the sponsorship, where we see this going is that this is a media platform. Online events is a media space. When you're attracting sponsors online, you need to be able to give rich analytics, who the people are that are attending. And with a platform like this, we really enable that to give that rich media and analytics in the background. And yeah, I think the key thing with an online event is understanding what do you want to do? Who is your audience? Do you need to monetize it or not? And then find the right platform, because there are hundreds of platforms. I mean, Zoom itself is a streaming platform that one could use, but it's very limited in terms of the functionality that you can do. So what we've done here is, you know, we bring Zoom into the platform, but give you a home to allow you to create your event with all the kind of bells and whistles from payments and registration and hosting and analytics. And yeah, so something we're extremely proud of is obviously it also runs 100% mobile. I think that's very key is, you know, people who are doing online events, we're seeing 70% of people are accessing it on their phone. So having a platform that really allows you to create a great customer experience, whether it's desktop or mobile, is critical. And that's what I have to share with you now.
Thank you. Shay, that's amazing. Thank you so much. And I think speaking from a destination marketing hat, having Andrew Barry and Shay in a room and knowing that this is from South Africa, for South Africa, for setting tone of the event industry, well done. I'm so super proud to be a South African with all this ideas and innovation and adaptation. And I think the resilience of event people is just this. We just are going with the flow. And this is something internationally as well. It happens internationally. I just this morning quickly pulled some event trends for 21, and it talks, sorry, that's your timer, Shai. I'm just putting it off quickly. and it talks about going into 21, micro experiences, safety first, making money with virtual events. How do we do that? Hybrid is the future. Is it the future? Audio to combat Zoom fatigue. We do need to understand that kind of environment. What are the new priorities? I just talked earlier about skills and IT, and then redefining engagement, you know, and what is the new fun? To me, that was quite important. And the report actually said it is not alcohol. So, and I think from event management perspective, that's probably the kind of things that we're looking for right now. And very important, I want to go back to kind of the IT and the competitive advantage of understanding this technical space, because we would probably imagine that we're probably going to evolutionize in virtual events, and maybe very quickly, like a few minutes. I don't see any questions in the chat, so we have like literally another 3 minutes to spend. I'm going to do a round robin now, because I want to ask you, each one of you, for the next event for 21, Barry, Andrew, Shai, just taking any of your events, do you see a virtual hybrid? Do you see it virtual excessive into a new, you know, what else did we learn and elevating that? Barry?
Yes, most definitely. We, especially on our shorter distances, because people won't necessarily travel for 5 or 10 kilometers to Cape to come and do it, but we also, you know, we've got responsibilities towards City of Cape Town and the Western Cape government that we still force people, get people to the Western Cape and the city to come and stay in the hotels and spend their money in the restaurants to, and also the greater economy that benefits from us. So our primary focus will always be the actual event, and that's what we always work towards, but definitely on the shorter distances. And then also in combination with that is we saw the success of the hybrid events in Potch and Pretoria, and what we're playing with the idea of to across the campuses in South Africa to include hybrid events for the shorter distances, because we definitely see an appetite for that.
I think that's interesting, and very quickly sharing from the conference space, we can now have other people in the venue that weren't necessarily there before. I think that's the one nugget that I also see from a kind of a virtual platform, whereas if it was in destination we still have to have a whole masterclass about in destination and person, but that you now have other involvement places that you didn't necessarily do in the past. Thanks you, Barry. Andrew, any closing comments or further comments?
Yeah, I think that's a very valid, very valid. And what if you look at a destination? I mean, we are primarily trying to get people to come and visit our space. In other words, in the Garden Route space. And you might think, okay, if you're going to go virtual, they're not going to come. But I don't think that's the case. We've got to sell it. So if you can't come this year, you can still experience it, and that will whet your appetite. So next year you're going to come. That's basically the core belief behind what we did this year. We did it because we're actually still selling the product for next year. And so the virtual is absolutely imperative, I think, going forward. And we've all learned this year that it's not that difficult to do. It does come with a cost, but it's not that difficult to do. But what we do, we try to do in our part of the world is we don't live in Cape Town. We live in the Garden Route, and we try and do and source most of our things locally, our service providers. We try and make the whatever churn we get into town, we try to keep here as much as possible to keep the little economy going, because it's a lot easier in a bigger city, but in a smaller towns and cities, you actually try and make that work. And that was one of the primary objectives of the festival, was that. Yes. And so making it virtual, we took a lot of that away. So we've got to get it back again.
That's so true, and that's definitely it's definitely a pertinent discussion point for most destinations and smaller regional in destinations. So that is completely true, and it's about skills and availability of infrastructure and those things. Andrew, you're absolutely right. Shay, any closing comments? Thanks, Andrew.
The sad reality is, I think for the first half or first quarter of next year, we're not going to see any big events happen in South Africa. You know, there's a lot of small events happening, and we are already starting to see the hybrid model. You know, so because you can have a small event of, let's say, 250 people or 500 people, and then how can you bring that online to a much larger audience, especially in the expo conferencing space? I think, you know, we're going to see a big explosion come early next year. And also what we're starting to see is, how do you bring that online experience into people's homes? So for example, on Andrew's event, like, is there an opportunity that you can deliver oysters to people's homes and let them experience that, you know, being part of the, so creating more of a interactive experience. And I think we're going to see a lot of that, and see people get a lot more innovative, creative, because I think we're in for a still good 6 to 12 months of tough times in our industry, and we need to, you know, we need to keep doing and innovating. So yeah, I think hybrid and is definitely the where it's going to be next year.
Totally. I thank you, Shay, thank you very much. I hate webinars that's an hour, because we always think that we can't sit still for an hour, but I wish I had another hour. I think the nuggets again is to we had three events, different kind of adaptations to a virtual environment, and they all worked. They weren't the effective way that we want them to be, but they definitely all worked, and the learnings are incredible. I think we're like a sponge at this stage of our careers in event industry about just absorbing, and surely Dr. Boa, for kind of, I don't know if Dr. Boa is still with us, but I suppose from master students and students in eventing, there's going to be a lot of things of these case studies coming forward. I want to thank everybody. Before I close, for sharing, for spending time, as well as our attendees. We didn't have a big attendee today, but everybody stayed on, and I really think that's useful. This content is valuable for us as an industry and for the province. And then I also want to thank the team behind the scenes. There's always people that puts up this together, and that's Mishvika and her team, Ray from the that's organizing the webinar from the back end side. And thanks for that. There is two more in the series of these masterclasses, and the one is taking place next year in January. That is going to still talk about event recovery and a new normal. On the 25th of Jan, and then there is also on the 11th of March, a webinar number 4, framing an events calendar for the new financial year, the role of the public sector with a new paradigm. So do look, you know, do watch out for those information that's going to come out. And then it lastly, just to thank everybody again, and I really wish everybody a good day. We are entering the festive season. We are entering a season that we've got to be super careful. Events are being seen as still a super spreader. There's a stigma around that, and we all know that events can be they can be managed properly. They can be regulated properly. We're used to regulation, and we as an industry need to demonstrate that, because it is a real fight that we're fighting to keep our industry alive. And I want to just sort of end off with that. So thank you. And I wish everybody a really fantastic day further on. Thank you very much. Goodbye. Thank you.
Bye. Thanks all. Nice meeting you, Barry. I'll say hello to the Collinses for you.
Barry Shay.
Sorry, please do.
Yeah, I think that we're all online. Thank you so much. I'm so amazed about this industry and the situation of it. It's actually mind-boggling to see what's coming around. But I think the real thing is still about the face-to-face and the real impact. But I don't know. It's not going to happen in 21. Probably we're probably looking at the same kind of adaptation level as we are for probably this quarter, and just internationally it looks, you know, the goalposts keep changing to say, oh well, in quarter four of 21 we'll probably have like a new normal, and I'm not even sure that's on the card. So I wish you all well. Thank you so much. Denver, you're still with us. I don't know if Mashfika's still with us. Ray, just thank you again. So are we sharing any of this? Mashfika, do you need something from everybody before we say goodbye? I don't know if she's still on array. Denver?
Hi, good day. Yes, we're definitely going to share it online. So Anis will do his thing and then we will share it with Denver. Okay. Rest of the team, and will be uploaded to our website. I just need to remind everyone that it takes about 4 working days for them to sort of just shrink and clean up nicely. If you guys are willing to share your presentations, please do so. That can be uploaded to the website as well. And then obviously Denver and his team is able to send out to all of the attendees that have come on board and that are willing to relook at the entire series. So it will live for a very long time on our website. It will be grouped together. So once we're done with the fourth one as well, it will live in the same space so people can always refer to it.
Okay. That's excellent. Thank you. Because I think the videos is really amazing to watch. It's a really good content. Perfect. Thank you very much. Have a really great day. I wish you all yes, Shay?
Are we able to obviously the attendees was probably quite a mix of people.
I can hear you, Shay.
Can you hear me? Hello?
We can. Yes.
Okay, I was asking whether it's possible that we could like send something to the attendees, just some more information. Maybe they, you know, there might be some business opportunities there, or you could share something on our behalf based on the regulations that you have.
Yeah, I hear you. It would be best for us to share it on your behalf. Please do feel free to send that information to Denver and they can then send it from their side. The only reason why I'm not allowed to send the list directly to you is...
I get it. Poppy.
Into that agreement. So I just don't want to...
Yeah? No, I get that.
But we can do it via and make a plan for you.
Cool.
Absolutely. Yes. Thank you. Sorry, I'm switched off my video because my Wi-Fi has been a bit slow. Okay.
All right.
I think that's a wrap. Thank you very much. Have a really good day. And thanks for your time.
Thank you. Okay. Nice to meet you, everyone.
Bye, Ray. Thank you. Cheers. Bye.